Christianity and the Bible, our gathering as a church, should always bring us back to death. We are all going to die one day. And so, if you want to take notes, Christ-centered leaders prepare others for death. In the church and outside of the church, we are hopefully preparing people to die. we can do anything. But as Christians, we aren't called to do anything. We are called to be a certain type of person. It's not just about what we do, it's about who we are. So that's what I got. That was a tangent, wasn't it? That's what he means by laying on hands. Like, if we are preparing pastors, if we're preparing leaders, he's saying you would lay your hands on them to pray for them, to send them into ministry. That's like, I grew up Baptist, and in the Baptist world, you'd go before a board of elders, and they would ordain you, and they would lay hands on you and pray for you and send you into ministry. That was kind of the normal Baptist practice. So we'll go back to the verses now. 5:22 continues and says, "Not laying on hands, do not share in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure." There is a shared guilt. Whenever I say, you know, we'll say Ross. Ross is the pastor. That way I can be the guilty one. Ross says, "Josh, I wholeheartedly feel that you are called to preach. And I want you to be the pastor. But I'm not a very good person. I might be able to be a dynamic speaker, but I'm not good Monday through Friday, Monday through Saturday." But Ross is platforming me. And so Ross actually shares in my guilt before God. That's significant. And as church members, as church goers, as also leaders, we don't necessarily want to just throw somebody up to fill a position. Because in a way we are saying you are good enough to be our leader. You are good enough to lead people. And so our approval means we will share in the guilt. Paul says, keep yourself pure. Don't be hasty to put people in positions too early. Then he continues in 24. The sins of some are conspicuous, going before them in judgment, going before them to judgment. But the sins of others appear later. So also good works are conspicuous, even those that are not, cannot remain hidden. Don't judge a book by its cover. Like I said, gifts and talents, they can get you really far in life. But character will keep you where you are. Character will make judgment easy. And so he's saying, you know, sometimes it's really easy to tell. This person does not belong in this position. But it is saddening to hear about all the pastors. I think there's been probably a dozen or more of the biggest pastors in America come out in the last 5 years and say, "I was having an affair. I was doing things that are inappropriate with outside of my marriage." I'm not going to list names, but a lot of people that I read their books, I looked up to what they were doing. I wanted my church one day, before this was all here, to look like their churches. And the damage that does to the world's view of the church, to see these pastors that pastor churches of tens of thousands of people, sometimes over 100,000 people globally, and say, "See, this guy can't even resist sin. Why should I believe what he's saying?" And so all the good that happened gets thrown out because they did something wrong. The sins of others sometimes take a while to show up. And like I said last week, don't like the word institution, we think, oh, institutions are bad. We need somebody who's going to be different than the institution. Because we distrust institutions. Politicians, you know, the institution of government, big business, they're all corrupt, they're all guilty. But that's the difference between an institution and institutionalization. So an institution, we'll just take like Summersville Grade School. That's an institution. It exists to educate students. Whenever it becomes institutionalized, it's no longer about the students learning and developing. It's about, well, we need a certain number of kids so that way we can support this building that we want to build, the number of staff we want to have. The institution forgets about its mission and becomes focused on the institution itself. So that's the difference. One's bad, one is very good. Because when we're individually driven, we just say, you know what, this guy seems good. Let's make him an elder. This person seems qualified for a position because they have the right skills. Let's just try it out. To be institutionally driven is what we should aim for. Where we progressively raise up leaders. As opposed to just stab in the dark, you seem good, right? There's a lot of times an interview is the best time a person acts at work. You can say a lot of things. You can make yourself seem really qualified. Resumes, Mariah goes through a lot of resumes, and sometimes she reads them to me. Very few times is it just like, just by your resume alone, I can tell you're not going to be a good worker. Use punctuation. But the damage that can take place by one wrong person being in leadership isn't worth it. And in evangelical churches, you know, I used to be Baptist, so I can talk about that. We're non-denominational, so I can talk about it. Non-denominational churches and Baptist churches are both very autonomous. There's not much outside structure to hold them accountable, and so it's very easy for wrong people to move up. And evangelical churches are strong in America because we grow. I know we got a lot of sick people today, but we're growing. We started with 15, and now we average around 40. We have tripled in a year. Growth happens because it's very easy to do things whenever it's a pastor and a couple other people making decisions. You know, there's the growth, you know, the excitement. It's a movement. It's a revival. But unfortunately, since it's so easy to just start and there's no accountability, there's the danger of thinness. There's the danger that maybe, you know, and I will fully tell you, I don't know everything. I don't know everything. I went to college, and the first thing I learned was, I don't know squat about ministry. I don't know squat about Maryland County 4-H. My two viewers are going to check it out now. Being a clock builder means in the church, you're not just someone who can get up and teach something to tell people how to live. You are someone who raises up people that can then share how to. So that way you're equipped to do this for others. So that way you're equipped to continue building the clock. Because unlike a clock, right, the clock has gears. It moves. It doesn't matter what you do, except Billy's cuckoo clock. He winds it. You know? But most of us, the clock just goes. The iPhone instantly knows daylight savings time has occurred and changes. The church will not. Christ. Yes. She will give you the whole Bible. She won't give you the whole curriculum. Caden, are you 20 yet? Nope. Teenagers are different. Maybe you need to learn to relate with teenagers by getting into First Friday and being involved in discussion. Because it should hopefully change your ideas about what kids are going through. You know, we get to hear a lot of different things whenever a number, probably in First Friday, number four guy. I get to show up. I get to discuss with kids. I get to have fun with the kids. I get to be hashtag sore for the Lord. But I'm growing my ability to relate with a generation that I'm not in. And that's wonderful. The younger generation needs to know more about Christ. Needs to know how to Christian values don't prepare you for the real world. Christian values don't prepare you for marriage. It is astonishing to me to hear, like, you know, I've seen the different shows that are on Lifetime. Married at First Sight, 90 Day Fiancé, all, you know, Mariah loves those shows sometimes. And I really get into it after about three episodes. But Married at First Sight, there was one time this girl was a virgin. And she got married to this guy at First Sight. And he was freaked out, like, what do you mean you're a virgin? Like, how would you know if you want to marry someone if you've never had sex with them? And Christian mind, I'm thinking, what an honor to be married with someone who's never had sex. Someone that was saving themselves for you, their husband. But to the world, our Christian values make no sense. Even though they've never tried them. Even though they say, this isn't, you know, this isn't right. So get involved with the youth to learn to relate to them so that way you can show them Christian values are important. And there's a lot of other ways to get involved, not just with the youth, not with just the kids. Mentoring is wonderful. And small group leaders, I try to pick somebody who has had maybe some teaching experience before this past time. I picked my communion meditators. I asked them if they wanted to help co-lead. Others had previous experience with teaching. Linda and my mom leads a ministry on Wednesdays called Celebrate Recovery. And Linda helps lead the youth. She's taught many classes. Like, I'm not just going to come up to you and say, hey, you've never taught anything. Why not change that? Institutionally minded. Institutionally driven. Let's build people up. Hey, you've never taught a small group before? Have you been a part of it? Yeah, you've been a part of one. Why don't you join ours this season? And we'll have you pray. We'll have you hold. Get your toes wet before you jump in the pool. So that way we can all say, yeah, this person does do a good job, has been around, has been built up in the church. So that way our church will last until Christ comes back. And that's my heart. I want to be able to reach some. Not just Mount Vernon. You know, we've got people from Wayne maybe on a screen or something like that. I want there to be enough pastors that we bring up in this church. Enough people who love the Lord and love others. That way each church will be able to have its own pastor at that church. Because I don't care about numbers. I care about, are we doing what we need to do for the kingdom? And if it would be better for Mulkey Town than Ross and Bethany driving 45 minutes to help Mount Vernon, for them to be able to reach their community, then that's what I want. I want us to be able to grow the kingdom. I just said the building bin because I haven't thought of the name yet. But like I said, we want what we're doing here to be able to impact throughout the generations. Just like what Christ did. Didn't just stop when Christ died. The Bible says that no power will prevail over the church. But that doesn't mean a church can't close its doors. Unfortunately, whenever churches don't get it right, sometimes they're forced to close. But I want us to keep going. I want us to end our race well. As we prepare to close, why don't you stand with me? So as we've talked about organizationally, our ending our race well, think about your race, your journey through life. Ask yourself the question, am I prepared to die? Can I say to live as Christ, to die as gain? If you can't say, Jesus is my Savior, His blood has paid for my sins, what are you waiting for? Come talk to me today. We don't know when the end is coming. Or if you could say, I'm secure in the Lord. I've included in your handout a bunch of different